And that makes it official. Good evening and welcome to our services tonight. Glad to have you in our Bible class. Hope that you are doing well. You got inside without getting too wet. Looking at the radar, we may still have some rain that comes over us during the Bible class hour. Good possibility. If that happens, we'll just go on until it gets too loud, and then maybe we'll pause for a minute. But anyway, we will be thankful that we're not meeting outside, as people used to do. Be a tough night for a tent meeting. But a lot of things have happened out in the rain. We're glad that you're here. We have a group of our folks who are off in Nevis tonight. Carrie and Pam, Steve and Jamie, I think Martha Osmer, traveled down today, met up with several other folks, and I think 20-some odd making the trip total, and we hope they are safe and effective in their work. They'll be back with us again in about a week, so keep them in your prayers. There will be lots of announcements, I'm sure, when the appropriate time comes. We'll leave that for our announcement maker and go on with our discussion. I intended last week for us to wrap up 1 Timothy chapter 6. We got close, left a couple of loose ends, and the bell got me. I want to go back at a couple of those loose ends tonight. I told you we were going to go on and do a more of a generalized study in Paul's epistles, and if I can squeeze any time at the end, I still want to have a little of that conversation, but there were several meaty chunks here that I didn't want to let go of before we wrap up, so that's where we'll begin tonight. Next week, Lord willing, I think Scotty Sparks will be with us to start off our summer series, and for the next 13 weeks, beginning next week, every Wednesday night, we'll have a guest speaker from mostly from our area. I guess the farthest away this year is coming from Kentucky. That's not true. The farthest speaker is coming from Texas. But he's not entirely coming for that reason alone. That'll be my brother, who speaks the next to the last Wednesday night in August. And he's coming out so that we can go to a preaching seminar in the end of August. But anyway, hope the summer series will go well and you will enjoy it and the men who come. Let's begin with a prayer, then we'll do our study for the night. Father, we're grateful for the day. We are thankful for life. We're grateful for every blessing, for food and shelter, for rain and sunshine. We're thankful for warm and cold, and the blessings that come to us and help us understand what a great world and life we're given. We thank you, Father, for the opportunity to meet tonight, to gather at the close of a day after many activities, to bring into our hearts and our thoughts the things of your Son, of your will for us. And we pray that our hearts will be open, that our minds will absorb the truth that you want us to know, and that we will allow these things to change how we live our lives. Father, we're grateful for every member here at Maysville. We ask your blessings on our group that's traveling this week, that you will give them safety both in their journeys and while they are overseas. Father, we ask your blessings to be continued with those of our family who have special needs. Father, we ask that you will continue to be with the Taylor family and provide for them the blessings that they need. Father, we are mindful of others who are in our midst who have special needs. We ask that you will provide for Eugene Renfro and the challenges that he continues to face, Miss Edna and her family. We pray that you will watch over them and provide for them. Father, we ask that you will be with Brother Philip Winburn and the needs that he has, that his treatments will be effective, and that he will be restored to his health. Father, we also ask that you will be with the family of Marie Elkins, that you will comfort them and bring a measure of understanding to the change in her life. Father, we ask that you will help each of us to reach out to others as we have the opportunity and provide the comfort that we can. We're grateful for the church at Maysville. We ask your blessings on our summer series and the various men who will come and deliver messages. We pray that these will be exhorting to us, that they will challenge our hearts and minds, and that because of their efforts, our lives will be fuller and that we will be more faithful. Go with us through this night. Forgive us of our sins. When our time is complete, bring us home. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. I wrongly assumed that I could quickly move through verses 20 and 21 of 1 Timothy 6, but I had too many little spots to stop, and I stopped at several. I want to read that verse. Actually, I'm going to read both verses, 20 and 21, and then we'll come up and pick up in the conclusion of verse 20, and then go forward. O Timothy, guard what was committed to your trust, avoiding the profane and idle babblings and contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge. By professing it, some have strayed concerning the faith. Grace be with you. Amen. The things that Paul told Timothy to avoid. And there are some things that simply need to be avoided. The word literally means turn away. And there is no way to really reason with them. And we read through several passages last week from 1 Timothy where Paul again used this word. What Paul then describes as what Timothy should avoid, contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge. I want to spend a moment talking about that. What is falsely called knowledge? King James Version, unfortunately, translated that word science. The word is not science. The Greek word should be, it's gnosis, which means that which one knows. The problem is, what do we know? Now, Pilate asked a very interesting question when Jesus was in trial before him, and that was, what is truth? And that is a challenge. In the world we live in, there is a phrase, a word, which you may or may not be aware of, called postmodernism. At some point, perhaps, we're going to talk about that term. I've thrown it out a couple of times. It refers to a group of ideas that attempts to describe the mentality of where we live now and the people who are around us now. And the concepts given over to this term, postmodernism, several of the qualities describe the idea that we cannot know anything. That's a problem. If it is not possible for us to know anything, then there is no knowledge. And that leaves people floundering in the dark. On the other hand, it is possible for people to claim knowledge when it's not knowledge. That also represents a problem and a number of different possibilities. You may or may not be aware that going back to as far back as the Sumerians, there was a practice that we know by its modern term of phlebotomy, the bleeding of human beings. Now, if you're not familiar with this so-called medical technique, then you're behind. Let's catch you up a little bit. There was an idea going way back that when people had sickness, when they had illness of various kinds, the problem was caused by what they called bad blood, or sometimes by too much blood. And so there were various practices to get rid of this blood, and so they would bleed people. Now, that would have come in very handy if they had been taking blood transfusions and donations and keeping it for other people, but it was way before that was understood. So if you were sick, a doctor might come in and bleed you. They would cut you open. They would cut open a vein and allow a certain amount of your blood to just flow out. Well, that became a very popular kind of thing. It was well known. It was well practiced. In fact, it is likely that George Washington's death was hastened by the fact that he was bled. If I remember correctly, and there was a physician who came in to treat him, and there were others who were dealing with him. But records indicate that someone came in and bled blood out of George Washington as many as five times in the 8 hours before his death. The man might have bled to death. He had other issues going on, but in an attempt to try to correct that, that's what took place. Well, we now know that was stupid. Illness had nothing to do with so-called bad blood, and people do not get ill by having too much blood. You don't have to have some of it taken out in order to be healthy. You may need to add some back, but you don't need to have any taken out, with very few exceptions. If you went back 100 years ago, 200 solidly, you would have come perhaps into a town and found a barbershop. Do you know why barbershops have little red and white and sometimes blue striped poles and a little circular sign? You know what that's for? That's to advertise that there's a dentist there, which dentists used to do lots of things. They were a local doctor if you didn't have one. They extracted teeth. They would bleed you if you needed it. And back in the Middle Ages, I think maybe in Paris, France, maybe other places, the bloodletters would put blood up in the window to advertise that that's what they did. So after it was drained out of people, they'd put it up in the window. Well, it's nasty. It becomes putrid. It draws flies. It XXX. They outlawed that, so they had to come up with some other way. So they put out a sign, and so it'd be red and white, and sometimes red, white, and blue. Do your research. That's where that came from. I'm glad today barbers are only involved in an occasional bloodletting. If you go in for a shave or a haircut, you may get nipped, but that's going to be about the worst of it. Well, that was knowledge of the day, scientific. It's certainly not. Up until 1970, the DSM, the Diagnostic Standard Manual for Mental Illness, for medical treatments of various kind, identified homosexuality as a sexual deviation. In 1970, a significant group of outraged homosexuals decided to take matters into their own hands. And they led a violent protest against the APA, the gathering of psychiatrists at their convention in San Francisco, and threatened them, many of them physically, if they continued that practice. It's historical. You can check it out. In the next version that came out, homosexuality was not listed as a sexual deviation any longer. You know what has happened between 1970 and today in regard to that topic. There was a discussion at the time regarding what constituted knowledge or science and understanding. Now, I would challenge you to say which one's which. Are we moving forward or backward? Depends on what group you're asking. In 1977, Time magazine had on the cover, how are you going to survive the coming ice age? Any of you remember reading that? You have a copy of it? In the late 1970s, the science of the day, a buzz was, we're all going to freeze to death. The earth is going to crust over with snow, and it's going to become so cold here that we're not going to be able to grow crops. We're going to all have to move to Mexico if we're going to live. No one in the northern continents are going to be able to survive. Canada is going to become a barren wasteland. That was what scientists were saying in the late 1970s. You know, Times Magazine for this year came out. How are you going to survive the coming global warming? Which one's established science? There are lots of scientists today who say they're playing fast and loose with the facts. The data does not support the idea of a man-made global warming. In fact, if you go back and look at historical data for a period of time, you will see that there are fluctuations in temperatures across dozens of years, hundreds of years, centuries, that have some pretty dramatic shifts. One of the very interesting things, as some of the glaciers have receded, is that under the glaciers, they found towns, houses, walls, developments. There were people living in these areas prior to the coming of the cold that caused them to have to leave. And the glaciers that took their land as they are warming back up are now exposing the fact that people used to live here. Now, what does that mean? Well, if you go back to that period of time where it got cold and warm, it's certain that there was no man-made effect changing it. I don't want to tonight get into a great discussion of what climatologists or others, politicians, are involved in. Just an awareness. Just as in Paul's day, Paul warned Timothy, don't become concerned about the contradictions of so-called knowledge. How old is the earth? And who knows for sure? I got a quote. I left it on my desk inadvertently. I intended to read it from Christian Courier. And the author, Wayne Jackson, was quoting from a scientist who said, when we look at the age of the earth, and even though he said, I believe X numbers of years, he said, I cannot pick up and show you a rock and prove to you that it is 5.4 million years old or whatever the number was. He said, I can't do it. It's not provable. How old is the sun? The same scientist arguing says, I have a theory. I believe certain data. Said, but given the data and someone suggested that the sun was less than 10,000 years old, he said, I could not dispute that with the facts that I have available to me. How do we gather information and knowledge? Sometimes people gather certain kinds of data and propose it and then theorize on it and then argue based on it, and it becomes a series of circular reasonings so that certain ideas lead to other ideas which take you back to the conclusion that you already believed in the first place. So-called knowledge. Watch out for it. Then Paul goes on. By professing it, some have strayed concerning the faith. Grace be with you. There are some people who will be very troubled by certain aspects of scientific, quote-unquote, scientific discovery, and it will lead them to conclusions that are unwarranted. Some even turning away from God. There are many, many things that we might look at in regard to so-called knowledge that would be in conflict with the Bible, but which really cannot be proved and are at best theories. The phrase in verse 21, by professing it, some have strayed from the faith. That's a concern. Paul makes mention of at least one issue of trouble which caused people to stray. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 18. Let's go to 17. Their message, I need to get to 16. Shun profane and idle babblings, for they will increase to more ungodliness. That's almost the same discussion we're in now. Their message will spread like cancer. Hymenaeus and Philetus are of this sort, who have strayed concerning the truth, saying that the resurrection is already past, and they overthrow the faith of some. What Paul is describing is that there are things that people say that are not true, but people will hold to them. A second issue is that they spread. These ideas, once put out into the marketplace, don't just rest with the person who said them first, but they have the ability to be picked up by others. And this statement in the final place, in verse 18, the specific issue was that these people said the resurrection had already taken place. Here, Paul had a group of people living in his day who said the end of time is, quote unquote, Jesus had already returned and gone, and that was it. Whoever's left is here. You may or may not be aware of what is sometimes called the AD 70 doctrine. And I'm not going to explain it in detail. I will say that those who promote this doctrine suggest that Jesus taught that he would return at the destruction of Jerusalem and destroy the Jewish people, and that he would take those, that generation, and escort them to heaven. But from then on, the rest of us, we're just left here, and nothing else is going to happen. The resurrection is done. Everybody who's in heaven's there already, and you're just out of luck. Well, this kind of a problem was already taking place, and I've oversimplified and described there are many more things that could be brought into this discussion regarding that. But it was taking place then. Truth is important. Sometimes it's a challenge, even coming to understand the scriptures properly. I was reading an article a day or so ago on a general introduction to the theology of Paul. It was a research project that had been put together for a religious denomination, for them to get together to do a study. Well, as I read through, the problem was that it was very poor scholarship. They were making statements regarding the Apostle Paul that simply are not true in regard to the Scriptures. They made statements concerning conflicts with what Paul believed and what the book of Acts teaches. Well, there were no conflicts. The supposed conflicts that they were describing were only because they did not properly interpret the texts that they were citing as examples. It was just plain old poor scholarship. Well, anyone listening to them could easily be misled. There are people who are told, you shouldn't believe the Bible because the Bible is just a book made by men. You ever heard anybody say that? Well, let's talk about that for just a second. You shouldn't believe it because it's just a book put together by men. Wow. If you look at the Bible, you're going to come up with some 40 authors involved in creating what we have as our Bible. And the writing of that material is going to cover approximately 1,500 years. Now, that's what they use as proof that this is unbelievable, because you shouldn't believe something that just a group of men wrote over a period of time. Okay. Let's explain then, how did 40-some-odd men, who had no, in many cases, connection with each other, over a period of 1,500 years, write material that is consistent in regard to the nature of God, the work of God, the plan of God, the prophecy of God, the revelation of God, the fulfillment of Jesus on the cross, the work of the gospel, the spreading of Christianity throughout the new world. How did they do that? The phenomenon would not be that 15 men decided at some point to write, or 40 men decided to write across 1,500 years something. But how do all of these fit together? You talk about something that's hard to explain. That's hard to explain. We are not, as a rule, prone to gathering up books and combining them together and ending up with a finished work. But that's what we have. When we start taking, beginning with the revelation of John, the last of our books in the Old Testament, the New Testament, and carry us back through the general epistles and the various works of the apostles, the book of Acts, the gospels that were written about Jesus concerning him, and then take us back through the gap of what we describe as the intertestamental period, carry us back into Malachi and the Old Testament prophets, going all the way back to the book of Genesis and the work of Moses. How did all of that get done by all of those men across all of that time and fit together? You see, when they say you shouldn't believe this because it does not have authenticity to it, their argument has made the case for an incredible phenomenon that requires an explanation. How did those men write those things? And the Apostle Peter will say, holy men of God did not write according to their own interpretation, but were rather carried along by the Holy Spirit. And as the Holy Spirit gave them utterance, so they wrote, so they spoke. And the words that we read are not just the words of mere men, but are the words of God. We can go back to the book of Genesis and we will find statements made from Moses where God says, write this in a book. Where Joshua is recording things for posterity, where David is recording things for posterity, where obviously others are writing. Jeremiah describes several specific times where he says, God told me to write this, so I did. When we start talking about Malachi, Zechariah, Haggai, these men said, God told me to write this. So those truths are important because they come from God. But if you turn away from them, you will lose that. Romans chapter 10, verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, hearing the word of God. Just as faith comes by hearing God's words, a lack of faith can come by hearing the words that are not from God and can change the hearts of people. The conclusion of verse 21 would probably be passed over quickly. Grace be with you all, amen. Or grace be with you, amen. Look at the works of the Apostle Paul and start reading every letter that Paul wrote that we have. Romans, 1 and 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, all the way down to the book of Philemon. And what do you find? Within the first verse or two, you will find Paul making a statement with regard to the word grace. Grace to you. And when he concludes his book, every single one of them, shortly before the conclusion, often in the very last verse, but not always, sometimes several verses before, he will bring up the topic and conclude with, grace to you. Often it is the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Sometimes just grace be with you. What saves us? In the words that Paul wrote to the book in the book of Ephesians, he has a marvelous conversation in Ephesians chapter 2. In a moment, if we get there, we'll talk about that work of what the purpose of Ephesians was. But as we come to chapter 2, we have this reading in 2 verse 4. God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. And raised us up together, and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Many denominational students and scholars have inappropriately misunderstood the topic of grace and God's grace. It is the case that without God's grace, there could be no salvation. We cannot earn, by works of merit, the right to be saved by God. That does not discount the requirement of obedience, but it does underscore God's grace. You cannot forgive a single sin that you commit. You can't. You can't undo it. In order for that sin to be forgiven, it must be forgiven by God's grace. Now, there is a methodology that God has put into place and has explained to us. Paul will describe in Romans chapter 3, and he says, in order for God to be just and the justifier of those who come to God, he had to give Jesus as the sacrifice. That payment, that sacrifice of Jesus as the Lamb of God, then makes it possible for God to freely forgive mankind. Now, some religious folks misunderstand this to say that God does everything that's involved in salvation. And they swing too far in one direction, to where they say God chooses those who are going to be saved, God saves those who are going to be saved, and there is nothing they can do about it. There is no action that they're involved in that makes any difference in their lives. They are saved by God. Many Calvinists, true Calvinists, accept this position as truth, that God has chosen from the beginning those who are going to be saved and those who are not, that God is sovereign in all things, that not a single thing happens without God's specific intent and oversight, which means God has already preordained that I was going to pick up this little clipboard here. And God has already decided what I'm going to do with it. The only problem is I haven't decided what I'm going to do with it yet. Whether I'm going to hold it here or toss it back on that pew or drop it on the ground. Now, which one am I going to do? When you let me know, your guess will be better than mine because I haven't decided yet. Okay, I've decided. It's back. Now, did God cause that? Nope. Did God allow it? Yep. What caused it? My choice. Free moral agency. Now, when we start reading in the book of Acts, and we come to Acts chapter 1, and Jesus tells the disciples to stay in Jerusalem until he overpowers them with the Holy Spirit. Truly, they're going to be overwhelmed. And then in Acts chapter 2, when that coming occurs, the pouring out of the Holy Spirit, what we describe as the baptismal measure of the Holy Spirit, that is, they were immersed in, and they began to speak as the Spirit gives them the words. And then in the second chapter of Acts, verse 14, Peter begins to preach that message, and now his words carry us through the end. And he talks about Joel, that these are the days that God spoke about, the Holy Spirit being poured out. And he talks about David and how that David prophesied that the Christ would come and that he would not see death, he would be raised from the dead. He wasn't talking about himself because David's tomb is still here. Peter's arguing that. And then he comes and says, and God has raised up Jesus. You killed him. God raised him. He made him the Messiah. He is God's anointed. And the Jews respond to verse 37, what shall we do? And Peter tells them, repent and be baptized for the remission of sins. Verse 40, with many other words, he warned them or told them, save yourselves from this wicked or untoward generation. And 3,000 of them that day believed Peter's words, received those words as truth, and acted upon them, and it says they were baptized. Did they do anything in order to be saved? Acts chapter 2, verse 47 says the Lord was adding to the church daily those who were being saved. These were being saved. Peter told them, this is what you need to do to be saved. How were they saved? Were they saved by grace? Yes. Were they saved by grace alone? No, they were not. They were not saved by grace alone. A component of their salvation was also their chosen obedience to that message. And if they had not chosen to obey, they would not have been saved, regardless of God's grace. Now, many religious people believe that is diminishing the role of God. They say, well, we can't tolerate that because now you're saying that it's up to men whether or not men are saved. That's exactly right. It is up to men as to whether or not men are saved. God has done the work through Jesus Christ. It is by grace that Jesus came. It's nothing that we earned. But we must be obedient in order for ourselves to be saved. We are not saved by the gift of Jesus alone, or all men would be saved. There could be no one lost if the grace of God covers all of humanity, and if there is nothing that's required in anyone for anyone to act in order for them to be saved, all would be saved. Because the gospel is for all. And Jesus died for all, as Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And while Jesus died for all, the message must be accepted, received as truth, and acted upon obediently. Paul's use of the word grace. And grace needs to be discussed. But the concept of grace is involved in every aspect of forgiveness. Amen. That's how Paul ends that word, or that chapter, which means, so be it. Let it be this way. For the moment or two that I've got left, I want to talk about Paul's work. Paul's place in the early church cannot be underestimated. Without Paul's writings, we wouldn't have the discussion in the book of Romans. We wouldn't have the conversation that we have in 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians. We wouldn't have Paul's reprimand of the Galatian church. We wouldn't have the discussion of the body of Christ that's found in the book of Ephesians. We wouldn't have the discussion of Jesus as preeminent that we have in Colossians. We wouldn't have the message that Paul had given to Timothy that we've been discussing through for the last several months, or in 2 Timothy that would go on if we were able to continue. All of these things would be gone. They are here for a purpose. When we go back and we look at the structure of the New Testament, the Gospels, the four accounts of Jesus' life, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, prepare the world for the message of who Jesus is and what his life was for. It explains what he did, why he did it to some degree, and gives us that basis for understanding God's love for us in the life of Jesus. When we go into the book of Acts, then, we have history. And it's what did we do? It's practical application of the gospel. The gospel was taken and it was preached in their world. And what happened when it was preached? Acts chapter 2, what happened when the gospel was preached? Men and women were baptized. We go to Acts chapter 8, and we have Philip up in Samaria. When he preached Jesus unto them, what happened? Verse 12, men and women, believing the words of Philip, were baptized. The conclusion of Acts chapter 8, he goes out and meets the Ethiopian eunuch, and he teaches him about Jesus from that scripture. In Isaiah 53, he preached Jesus unto him. And what happened as they traveled along the way, it says they came to a certain water, or to a place where there was water. And the eunuch said, see, here's water. What hinders me from being baptized? They were preaching the message of Jesus. It included baptism, and he was baptized. The church is their beginning. By the time we get to Acts chapter 13, we have Saul and Barnabas who are going out, and they are preaching, and they are establishing churches. Those assemblies, those groups, those local bodies are going to be following after Jesus, but they're going to have their own issues in life. And so as over time, Paul is going to interact with those local churches. And he's going to write letters to those local churches. He's going to write a letter to those saints who were in Rome, those Christians who were there, Romans. He's going to write letters to the saints of Galatia, the churches of Galatia, our book of Galatians. He's going to write letters to churches like Corinth that had a number of difficulties. And so we find that the Apostle Paul's work involved at least three things. He had contact with them, expressing his relationship to them as an apostle. He had comfort or confirmation in them that he acknowledges that they're Christians. He recognizes what they have done and their important place in Christianity. But he also does a third thing. He corrects them. And it is the correction found in the various epistles that represents part of the most important reason for the epistles. On any given day, it would be possible for me to decide to fly off somewhere. And I could take off from Moontown and decide that I'm going to fly up to Fayetteville. Now, if I'm going to fly from Moontown to Fayetteville, I don't need very sophisticated guidance to get there. Just go north, generally, and you're going to find Fayetteville. If you don't get very high, you're going to see the town and the airport that's there. But what if you were going farther than that, or to a destination where you couldn't see? I would need a map. And using that map, I would have to make a course correction. I would need to be altering my route so that I got to the place I wanted to get to. The epistles are course-correcting documents. They are the ideas written along the way that carry someone from the beginning of who Jesus is and that you have become a Christian to exactly how you should live your life along the way to fulfill that message, to reach heaven. Without the epistles, we would have a huge emptiness in how we should live our lives daily. If you had only the Gospels, you had only the book of Acts, there would be virtually no guidance for the day-to-day activities that the church is involved with, because they're not found there. You find those in the works and the writings of Paul and Peter and John and Jude and James and whoever wrote Hebrews. There are people today in some churches who say, we don't need to talk about the letters. We need to talk about the gospel. We need to preach Jesus. We don't need to study the writings of Paul. We don't need to be involved in the theology of Paul. We need only to have Jesus. What they're really wanting to do is say, we don't want anybody to tell us how to do church. We don't want anyone to tell us how we should live our lives, because those are the guiding documents, those letters of Paul, those corrections along the way. And the writer of Hebrews said, we had fathers who corrected us along the way. They taught us, they disciplined us. And God is going to do the same. How does God do that? Much of it comes through the writings of the Apostle Paul and others. I hope that when we begin again in September and start a new study, that after the summer, you will not have completely forgotten all that we talked about in 1 Timothy. And if I could leave you with just one thought tonight, it would be this. The Bible is necessary for us to understand how to be pleasing to God. We cannot do it without the Scriptures. It is important that those Scriptures be properly interpreted and properly applied to our lives in order for them to provide true guidance. Paul told Timothy, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that does not need to be ashamed, handling properly the Word of God. May I suggest to you that that is a challenge that we will be facing until the end of time, that we properly handle the Scriptures. May God bless you in your study, and we hope for a great summer. Thank you.